Today on Christian World News, a young Christian runs away from her Muslim family. She says she's afraid for her life.
And in Chiapas, Mexico, evangelicals are persecuted. Well, that doesn't stop these young missionaries from preaching the gospel.
Plus, in the Philippines, war and natural disasters have left thousands of people without homes. We'll tell you about the ministry that's helping keep them alive.
A Christian girl flees her Muslim family out of fear for her life. Hello, everyone. I'm George Thomas.
And I'm Wendy Griffith. Rivka Berry converted from Islam to Christianity 4 years ago. She says when her father found out, he threatened to kill her.
And now she's waiting to see if a Florida court will send her back. Dale Hood reports.
I wrote my parents a note. I said, I refuse to deny Jesus and he's my Lord and Savior. And I pray you find his forgiveness and mercy, and I love them both dearly. I wrote that, but they never showed it to the police officers.
I will get rid of them.
A court placed Rivka Berry with a foster family of evangelical Christians. A court will decide August 21st whether Berry will be emancipated and allowed to stay in Florida or return to her parents in Ohio. She fears her parents will send her back to her native Sri Lanka, where she will be killed.
They have to kill me. My blood is now halal, which means that because I am now a Christian, I'm from a Muslim background, it's an honor. If they love God more than me.
Berry, who became a Christian about 4 years ago, befriended pastors Blake and Beverly Lorenz of Orlando, Florida, in a Facebook group. When her family discovered her faith, she bought a bus ticket and went to Florida, where she showed up on the Lorenz doorstep.
It became very real when we went to court, and she saw her dad. She almost curled up in a fetal position. She began to shake. She was in fear of her life.
I had to hide my Bible for years. I would go outside to pray. When my dad was asleep was when I went outside to pray. I snuck out to Christian prayer meetings and in fear of my life. And finally, this day had come where I was confronting my dad.
There is an increasing core group who honor murder their daughters, certainly for leaving Islam, but they murder them for refusing to wear hijab. They murder them for becoming too Western.
Her father came to Florida to bring her back, but denied the family would have her killed. Dale Hurd, CBN News.
Rivka's father says his daughter has been brainwashed by the Christians she's living with. Muhammad Berry spoke to an Ohio TV station and denied the allegations that he threatened to kill his daughter.
Not at all. It's completely false. It's, honestly, it's not my daughter who is speaking. I feel that she has been coached to say these things.
A police detective in Ohio is also questioning Rivka's claims about why she ran away, saying the girl's father seems genuinely concerned and worried about his daughter. And a Christian lawyer representing her mother says he doesn't believe her father threatened her. Rivka says those who doubt her charges don't understand the value that Islam places on protecting honor.
Do you really think that this is true, or do you think this is just a threat?
Yeah. There's actually hundreds of cases that are back to like me. Amina and Sarah, they were forced to go back home. They were killed by their dad. Like, this is not just some threat. This is reality. This is truth. This is reality. If, how many more cases? If you want, there's case after case. There's hundreds of them. I am one. I am one of hundreds. I want to be free. I want to worship Jesus. I want to go to church on Sundays and read my Bible and see Jesus is alive whenever I want to. You guys talk about religious freedom? No! I don't have that. I want to be here and I want to worship Jesus freely. That's what I want. I don't want to die.
Rivka said at one point she was prepared to be a martyr for Christ. Now she's asking Christians worldwide to please pray for her.
And Rivka talks about this so-called honor killing. How common is this in the Muslim world? Earlier I asked an expert on Islam about the danger Rivka faces. And joining us now is Robert Spencer of the website Jihad Watch. Robert, Rivka is clearly terrified in this interview. Does she have cause to be afraid?
Oh, she has every reason to be afraid. She's got actually two reasons to be afraid. One is that the Islamic religion, all of its sects and all of its schools of law, mandate the death penalty for those who leave Islam. And also then there's the shame honor culture that runs through the Islamic world that commands a parent to cleanse the purity of the family if it is perceived to have been sullied. And in this case, it has been sullied by the girl's conversion from Islam to Christianity. And so for those two reasons, her family wants to kill her, as she herself well knows.
So in essence, blood cleanses honor in the minds of her mom and dad.
Yes, very much so. The paramount thing to preserve is the family's honor, and the one who has sullied it must be killed. This is a really extraordinary belief, but it runs throughout the Islamic world.
And at one point, Rifka can be heard telling a reporter, you don't understand Islam in the context of honor killings. What is it that we don't understand in the West about Islam?
One of the things that we don't know about Islam, that we don't understand about Islam, that I think Rifka had in mind, was the fact that it mandates the death penalty for those who leave the faith. That is routinely denied by Islamic spokesmen in the West. Unfortunately, the only people who don't seem to have gotten the memo are Muslims who do carry out the killings of Muslims who have left Islam all over the Islamic world.
We hear, Robert, about these kinds of crimes such as honor killings in Muslim countries. Is it starting to happen more over here in the United States and Canada?
Yes, it is. There are honor killings that have taken place just over the last year or so in the United States. There was the killing of Amina and Sarah Saeed, whom Rifka Bari mentions in her video, that they were murdered by their father on New Year's Day 2008 because they had non-Muslim boyfriends. And there was the case in Canada of Aksa Parvez, who was murdered by her father a couple of years back for refusing to wear the Islamic hijab, the headscarf.
What should Western societies do to keep this kind of religious fanaticism from spreading?
Law enforcement officials and the media need to start saying, look, we know that Islam commands death for apostates, and we know that in Islamic countries all over the world, honor killers are given lighter sentences than other murderers, and this is on Islamic grounds as well. And so you're going to have to start cleaning house, and we need to call upon the Muslim community in America, in North America as well, in general, in Canada and elsewhere, to start to institute transparent, open, honest, inspectable programs that teach against these doctrines and attitudes, or else they should not be welcome in the United States.
Robert Spencer of Jihad Watch, sir, thank you for joining us on the broadcast this week.
Thank you.
Turning now to Somalia, where four more Christians have been executed by radical Islamists in that East African nation. International Christian Concern, a human rights agency, reports members of the Al-Shabaab extremist group kidnapped and beheaded the believers late last month. The four worked for an organization helping orphans in southern Somalia. A spokesman for Al-Shabaab said the workers were guilty of abandoning Islam. An eyewitness told ICC the four Christians were given the chance to renounce their faith in Jesus Christ and to embrace Islam. They refused, even though the terrorists promised to release them. Al-Shabaab has been waging war against the tiny Christian population in Somalia. It's seeking to overthrow the government and establish an Islamic state.
There is a crackdown against Christians in Iran. Compass Direct News reports at least 30 were arrested in the past 2 weeks. Most have been released. However, eight are still in prison, including these two women you see here. Mariam and Mazria were arrested for ministering to prostitutes. The women recently came before a judge who ordered them to recant their Christian faith. They refused. The women were then sent back to jail indefinitely to think about their decision.
Hundreds of protesters gathered in Washington, D.C. this week to draw attention to the plight of Pakistani Christians. The past few months have seen an increase in violence in Pakistan, and Christians often have been the targets there. Over the past few weeks, eight Christians have been killed in the city of Godhra, and scores of families have been burned out of their homes.
16 families burned their house and animals and everything. He burned, put the gasoline and burned everything. That's the reason, because he's a Christian. All Christian community, they do bad happen every day, every day, every day. Dead. Kill the people.
There were burned people, burned alive, children, mobs, churches. Anytime anything happens in the West here, the Muslims attack Christians because they associate Christianity with the West.
The protesters are also calling for the repeal of Pakistan's anti-blasphemy laws. Radical Muslims use those laws as an excuse to persecute and kill Christians.
CBN's Operation Blessing is bringing emergency aid to the victims of those attacks in Pakistan, along with the American Center for Law and Justice and their Pakistani partner organization, the Community Development Initiative. The three groups are helping Christian families recently displaced by the violence. Operation Blessing is feeding about 300 men, women and children for a week. The aid organization is also purchasing 60 electric floor fans for the families to help them cope in the intense heat.
When Christian World News returns, these Christians suffer some of the harshest persecution in Latin America, yet they're ready to preach the gospel to the nations. Stay with us.
CWNews.org, your constant news source on the World Wide Web. Find daily updates on the global church. Watch the weekly broadcast.
Three former presidents come together to honor the life and ministry.
Also available in podcast. The in-depth insights into our reporter blogs.
Taliban kidnapped at least 18
South Korean Christians.
Your online news source for complete coverage of the global church.
CBN presents Superbook for a new generation. Now reimagined from the classic CBN cartoon, a new series featuring amazing Bible stories brought to life using state-of-the-art animation.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
Your kids will love being entertained while they learn biblical values like courage, loyalty, humility, and faith as they join Chris, Joy, and Gizmo in their travels through time. In the first episode, A Giant Adventure, Chris and friends land in ancient Israel, where they meet David and witness his fierce battle against the giant Goliath.
You come to me with sword and spear, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts.
Your gift of $25 or more will help create future Superbook episodes. As our thank you, you'll receive a special edition DVD of the first episode and our brand new Superbook trading cards. Give your child the advantage of learning God's Word. Superbook, superpower to change your life.
The Bible is filled with stories of the miraculous. But are miracles a thing of the past? Jesus still does miracles today. Experience his incredible power in Pat Robertson's newest teaching, Miracles Beyond Measure.
If you have faith in God, then nothing will be impossible for you.
Miracles Beyond Measure, available now.
The Mexican Supreme Court recently released 20 evangelical Indians from prison. They said prosecutors had used illegally obtained evidence in their conviction. Over 30 additional prisoners may be released in the coming weeks. The men were accused in the massacre of 45 Indian villagers in the state of Chiapas some 12 years ago. The prisoners maintained their innocence but said they don't hold any resentment against those who accused them.
And joining us now is our chief Latin America correspondent, Stan Jeter. Stan, why were these evangelicals in prison for 12 years?
They were accused of this massacre that happened in a place called Acteal. 45 people were killed. It was a very politically charged situation. You had the conflict of Catholic versus Protestant. You had the conflict of some rebel sympathizers, there's some Zapatista rebels in the area, and the government party. And all of this created such a mix that these people were stuck in the legal system for all of this time. They weren't able to get their freedom.
Mm. Wow, that's a long time. But why were other Indians protesting their release?
Well, because these were probably relatives of the prisoners or sympathizers, relatives of the massacre victims,
Oh, right.
Or sympathizers of the rebels in the area. And so they were saying that these people were guilty. You know, they would not accept that they could be innocent, and they were afraid to have them come back to their communities.
Well, what will they do now that they're free after 12 years?
Well, that's a good question, because there's possible violence if they go back to their home community. So the government is arranging for them to live in an area about 50 kilometers away from their original homes. And some Christian organizations are helping to resettle them in this new area, although some really would like to go back home.
Now, I understand there's still some Christians in prison. What about them?
There will be further trials and further legal workings to get them, hopefully, to get them out. You know, I visited these prisoners about 4 or 5 years ago and talked with them, and it's a very difficult situation for them. They've suffered a lot.
What were the conditions like in that prison?
A typical Latin American prison, but they were cheerful, they were hopeful, and in fact, a number of them have strengthened their Christian faith while in prison.
It's amazing that that can happen, even in the darkest places.
Absolutely.
Stan Jeter, thanks so much for that. We appreciate it. George?
Thank you. Evangelical Christians in the state of Chiapas suffer perhaps some of the worst persecution in the Spanish-speaking world. Believers there are praying for the persecution to end, not just in their country, but around the world. And they want to see the gospel spread across the globe. Gary Lane has more from Chiapas, Mexico.
Chiapas is one of the most persecuted areas in the Latin world. Yet with flags of various nations waving, believers of the Alas de Aguayo Church in San Cristobal de las Casas pray for others who suffer for their faith. Pastor Esdras Alonso Gonzalez has documented at least 20 reported cases of persecution in the area this year. He led his congregation in prayer for suffering brothers and sisters in Christ around the world and for more missionaries, including young Chiapans, to be sent to restricted nations. Missionaries like Patricio. He's preaching at a Friday night service in the northern mountain village of San Jovel. He says he wants to bring the gospel to areas where it isn't known. Patricio and fellow student Danielle are among aspiring missionaries attending the Emmanuel Bible Institute in San Jovel.
I'm learning a lot more than I thought I could learn. I'm learning to understand what the spiritual life is all about. The Word of God tells us not just to preach in the local areas or just in our state, but to all the world.
Some of these students feel called to serve in tribal communities in Chiapas. Others want to take the word to restricted nations. 24-year-old Zaneta says God may be calling her to Pakistan.
The need of the women in Pakistan really caught my attention. I started praying to the Lord, and I told him that if he wanted me to go to Pakistan, then I would do that. And if it were his will that I give my life in Pakistan, then I would accept that.
For now, Zaneta is pouring out her life in tribal villages in Chiapas, where many traditionalists oppose the gospel. She and her cousin Anna often traverse footbridges to reach remote mountain towns. They've experienced victories, but also disappointments. They were overjoyed when asked to start a Bible study in the home of several people they had led to Christ. When some family members discovered the meetings, they shut them down and asked the missionaries to leave.
Truthfully, we were sad about it, but we believe it will be possible that the door will open and the Lord will be able to touch their hearts.
The Christians of Chiapas, praying for hearts to change and for God to send more workers for the harvest, including young aspiring missionaries with a godly vision for the future.
I may not be an important person, but I know the Lord will use me to accomplish great things.
Gary Lane, CBN News, Chiapas, Mexico.
Up next, Muslims and Christians are left homeless in the southern Philippines. Now a ministry is using the situation to build bridges between the two communities.
As co-host of the 700 Club, I see incredible stories of God's faithfulness to our viewers every day. It builds our faith to see what God is doing in people's lives. Perhaps you've seen a miracle in your finances. We'd like to share your story with others so that they too can be encouraged. Please call 1-800-759-0700 or log on to CBN.com. We want to hear from you. Your life can inspire others.
I have the privilege of traveling all over the world and seeing firsthand the life-changing things you make possible through your partnership. Thank you for joining the 700 Club. Here in India, you're demonstrating the love of God to such wonderful people, most of whom are in great need, both physically and spiritually. You're bringing hope and joy to millions around the world.
Just like you did for Chen Yu, born with a serious heart defect, doctors said he would soon die. His parents couldn't afford surgery. That's when you provided the operation that saved his life.
Your monthly gift makes it possible to heal the sick, feed the hungry, and preach the gospel, both at home in America and throughout the world. So please watch for this mailing and send in your pledge. Imagine lifting someone's life out of despair and filling it with hope instead. That's what you make possible every day. And it only happens because you were there.
It's the one thing news viewers can agree on.
They want change.
Now, the world's leading Christian news organization brings you national, international news and analysis throughout the day. Mornings, the busy lunch hour, late afternoon, and evenings. It's news with a Christian perspective whenever you want it. Available on the web 24/7 at cbnnews.com.
Well, this summer, flash floods in the southern Philippines have left hundreds of families homeless. That's on top of the ongoing war between the government and Muslim rebels that has forced thousands more into evacuation centers.
CBN's Operation Blessing is helping alleviate the suffering of these families, both Christian and Muslim. Lucille Talusan reports from Mindanao.
For 3 weeks this summer, many towns in the southern Philippines were submerged in flood waters. More than 3,000 residents lost their homes. Felix Alcala is going through the debris of his house, gathering materials he can use to build a new one. In the meantime, he and his family of 13 children are staying in a makeshift tent beside the road.
Now that we lost our house, it's really a big problem because my children don't have a place to sleep, and because they are exposed to the changing weather, they become sick with fever and cough.
Another problem is the shortage of food. The floods destroyed not only the crops, but also the roads and bridges used to transport the products.
Along with the houses, the middle part of the bridge that you can see behind me was also swept away by surging flood waters. But on top of this natural disaster, the people here have no choice but to live with serious problems like kidnappings, bombings, and attacks of Muslim rebels.
In addition to the natural calamities, man-made disasters like the armed conflict between Muslim rebels and government troops add to the suffering. Naraisa Kalim still mourns the death of her younger brother, who was killed when Muslim rebels attacked their village a year ago.
It's been more than a year, but I still can't accept the death of my brother. We cannot go back to our village because it is not safe and they already destroyed our house. Our life has become miserable.
The fighting has displaced thousands of residents like Naraisa, who now live in congested evacuation centers. Unsun Dumagil is Muslim and the town's municipal secretary.
Economically, they are depressed. Maybe 90% of their food are coming from NGOs, which they are already dependent of.
Operation Blessing visited the different evacuation centers to provide medical assistance and distribute food and other relief to the victims. Naraisa is happy she had her baby examined by an OB volunteer doctor. She is also thankful for the rice, beans, and canned goods the ministry gives away to refugees because she can now feed her children. Felix is glad for the medicines that will help his children fight infection and fever. But he says what touched him more was the prayer of the counselor for him.
I felt joy and a sense of hope when the counselor prayed for me. Most of us have forgotten about God, and maybe that is why we got the flood. It's a reminder for us to turn back to God.
Operation Blessing's Albino Mercado Jr. believes that the disaster relief efforts sow peace and hope to the region.
Through these efforts, the Christians can show how much we love the Muslims and how Jesus loves them as well.
Like the Operation Blessings, it is headed by a Christian, so we very much welcome them, and that we are very optimistic that it would build stronger relationship between the Christians and the Muslims.
Lucille Talusan, CBN News, Northern Mindanao, Philippines.
And George, you heard what that man said. He said, what I appreciated even more than the medicines they gave us was the prayer. He says it gave us hope. You know, and that's what people need more than anything, even more than medicine. They need the hope that only comes from Jesus Christ.
That's absolutely right. And in the midst of that incredible suffering and the way they live, you see the conditions, but yet they have hope. And people come in the name of hope in Jesus Christ.
It's amazing. Please pray for them.
That's right. Well, if you want to help Operation Blessing in its work, just visit our website at CWNews.org. We'll be back right after this.
Do the miracles of Jesus still happen today?
Pastor had walked over and prayed for this illness, and all of a sudden, everything stopped.
Can the blind be made to see?
I could see two walls at one time. I could see things. I could see stuff over here and here.
Are the dead brought back to life?
When I prayed that prayer, Fatima, raised in the name of Jesus,
immediately I found myself in my body.
Jesus still does miracles today. Experience his incredible power in Pat Robertson's newest teaching, Miracles Beyond Measure.
If you have faith in God, then nothing will be impossible for you.
Join the 700 Club and receive this life-changing new teaching, Miracles Beyond Measure, available now.
Daddy?
Yeah, buddy?
How many nickels are in a dollar?
There are 20 nickels in a dollar.
How do birds fly? Does milk really make my bones stronger?
Yeah.
Daddy, when we die, will we go to heaven?
Do you have the answer to life's biggest question? Call the 700 Club. We'll help you find answers to the important questions life brings your way.
Christian World News, your window to the global church. For stories of revival.
Another revival.
Persecution.
Relatives and fellow Christians mourn him.
First country over the international dateline.
I'm George Thomas in Baghdad, and coming up on the broadcast, an exclusive interview.
And the impact of Christian leaders. Watch Christian World News.
And finally this week, the Bible teaches to put others before yourself.
Amen, brother. And that's exactly what one North Carolina teacher did for his coworker. Longtime teacher Jim Bell sacrificed his own job for the sake of a fellow teacher. Bell taught social studies to thousands of kids throughout the years at Owen Middle School. He intended to continue a few more years before retiring, but budget cuts and the prospect of three teachers losing their jobs forced him to make a tough decision.
It's time for me to get out. If one of them got kicked out, they might not ever go back into the school business.
He's just such a good man, and I know he saw me in tears that day, and I know he was put in a tough spot.
Bell says he resigned to make room for new, younger teachers. He hopes they'll teach and touch as many lives as he's been able to. So that's what it's all about.
Yeah,
putting
sure is.
Others before yourself. And you know, he looks like he might be ready for a break, so God bless him.
God bless him.
Well, that's all our report for this week. Thanks for joining us.
Join us right here again next week. Until then, goodbye and
God bless you.
All right, see everyone.
Thanks for letting me say it.
Sure.